المعصومين المنتجبين يا ليتنا كنا معكم سادتي فنفوز فوزا عظيما. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. أقم الصلاة لدلوك الشمس إلى غسق الليل وقرآن الفجر، إن قرآن الفجر كان مشهودا. آمنا بالله، صدق الله العلي العظيم. صلوات ما صلى على محمد. For the love of Abba Abdullah al-Hussein, with the loudest of our voices, sallu ala Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad. Ma salli ala Muhammad. For the love of Imam Sahib al-Asr wa al-Zaman, arwahuna lahu al-fida, sallu ala Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad. Ma salli ala Muhammad. Once again, we thank Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for another wonderful moment and opportunity to continue to acquire the understanding of our religion, especially in this holy month of Ramadan. We ask Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala to accept our humble effort in this holy month, inshallah, and forgive our shortcomings in this holy month of Ramadan, inshallah. The verse I've just quoted from glorious Quran is from Surah 17, verse 78, that is Surah Al-Isra, where Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala discuss about the timing of salah and the importance of salah. And our topic for tonight, this course, will be the power of salat. And our examination will be of four stages. The first stage, we look at the importance of salah in the life of the prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and in the lives of Ahl Bayt alayhim alafu tahiyyati wa salam. And then second step of my examination, I will look at our need for salah. Do we need salah or we don't need salah? Is there any need for me to pray or there is no need? I'm doing Allah favor or who am I doing the favor to? So therefore, second stage, we will look at our need for salah. And third stage, we will look at the required and standard salat in the eye of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Which salat is standard and which salat is required by Allah? Because when we talk of a required and standard salat, we are talking of a salah that makes one soul to ascend to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not every salat makes our souls to ascend to Allah. There is a particular salah, when you perform it, your souls will ascend to Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And lastly, we will look at those factors and those conditions that when one meets them in his or her life, his salat will be regarded as salat that ascend to Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad. Without a shadow of doubt, salat occupies a very prominent position within the teachings of Islam and in the eye of Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Therefore, you realize that all prophets sent by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah commanded them to make salah. And Allah used the word salah to signify the importance of salah in the life of those prophets and the life of those followers of the prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We begin with our prophet Ibrahim alayhi alafu tahiyyatu wassalam. When you see, there are so many verses in Quran where Allah talks about Ibrahim and talks about salah. One verse which Ibrahim himself made dua, Rabbi ja'alni muqima salah wa min dhurriyati rabbana wa taqabbal dua. Ibrahim made dua and asked Allah, Ya Allah, make me Ibrahim and my dhurriya, family, amongst those who establish salah. Prophet of Allah is making dua that Allah ij'alni muqim as-salah wa min dhurriyyati rabbana wa taqabbal dua. Not only our salah, but Allah, I Ibrahim ask you, when I and my offspring and children raise up our hands and ask you in dua, ya Allah, accept our dua. That is Ibrahim. Now you go to Isa Ruhullah, Jesus Christ. Isa alayhi salatu wassalam, when Maryam gave birth to Isa, people were so dumbfounded. They were so astonished because to them, Maryam was so modest. And now Maryam is delivering a baby. Who is the father of the baby? We all know the story in Quran. When they came to Maryam, instead of Maryam responding by herself, she pointed to the baby to respond. And the baby made it very clear. Inni Abdullah atani al-kitaba wa ja'alani nabiyan wa ja'alani mubarakan aina ma kuntu wa awsani bis-salah. The son, who is an infant, responded to the queries of people in regard to the personality of his mom. I am a servant of Allah, and Allah has given me a book. And Allah made this a different discussion. Why is he a prophet when he's young? That's another discussion. Therefore, we said, if people say, why Imam Ali is Imam at the age of 10 or 9, we said, Isa became prophet when he was an infant. Isa responded, Awsani bis-salah. Allah ordained that I should establish salah. Now come to Musa alayhi salatu wasalam in Surah Yunus. Allah said, Wa awhayna ila Musa wa akhi. We've revealed to Musa and his brother Harun, Allah mean here, that Musa and Harun, they should enter the city. Then the end of the verse, Allah said, وَجَعَلُوا بُيُوتَكُمْ كِبْلًا وَأَكِيمُوا الصَّلَاةَ وَبَشِّرِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. Allah said to Musa, you Musa and Aaron, make your houses Qibla, means direction to stand and worship Allah. But then Allah didn't stop there. He said, Musa, you and Aaron and all your followers, أَكِيمُوا الصَّلَاةَ, establish salah. So therefore, salat is so important. Not only to us, but to all the prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now to cut long story short, come to our own beloved prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. Not in one verse. There are other verses in Quran. But we limit ourselves to this verse that I've just quoted from glorious Quran. Where Allah is addressing Rasulullah. أقم الصلاة لدلوك الشمس إلى غسق الليل وقرآن الفجر إن قرآن الفجر كان مشهودا. Allah, in this particular verse of Quran, this also another response to an argument. Why we make only three salats? Some people think Shias, they make only three salat. Because he said we join. Of course we join because Prophet joined. But now people argue, they said no, but salat time is five. He said no, Allah mentioned in Quran salat time is three. And one of the verses that prove that is this particular verse of Quran, chapter Isra, verse 78. Allah said to Rasulullah, Akim as-salah, establish salah. Rasulullah, our own prophet that we love and follow, Allah is telling him, Ya Rasulullah, Akim as-salah, what of I and you? If Allah tells Rasulullah to establish salah, it means Allah indirectly is telling all of us to establish salah because there is a benefit for each and every one of us. Therefore, I said, لِدُلُوكِ الشَّمْسِ. Establish salah during the declining of the sun. Here, دُلُوكِ الشَّمْسِ is referring to Zuhur and Asr. Then Allah said, إِلَى غَسَكِ اللَّيْلِ. To the commencement of the night. It means Allah is talking about Maghrib and Isha. Then at the end of the verse, said, Wa Quran al Fajr. Inna Quran al Fajr kana mashhuda. And also the reading of the Fajr. But here it's referring to Salatul Fajr. That establish it and read it. So in this verse, Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala is telling our own beloved Prophet, establish salah. It's fi'lu amrin. It's a command from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to Rasulullah to establish salah. Now let's come to Ahlul Bayt. Our beloved Imam, Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen, salawatullahi wa salamuhu alayhi. On the eve of Siffin, they all came, the enemies came. Mawla Kainat was with his companions and the enemies were with their companions. And the enemies were preparing themselves and Amir al-Mu'mineen was busy performing salah. Companions came, Mawla, these people are well armed and they are heading towards us. Why are you busy with salah? Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen said, if they have recognized Salat, we were not going to be here. If they have recognized and established Salat, and Salat has that spiritual impact in their lives, they will not come and fight the Imam of their time. It means they performed Salat, they did not establish Salat. Because whoever established Salat, Salat will have a very greater impact in his or her life. Therefore, Mawlai Kainat taught us in many riwayat, especially when he was about to leave this world. We know Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen is a shaheed of Salah. Imam died while performing Salah. That tells I and you, the last thing you can play with in your life is Salah. Shaheed Mihrab, Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen. Therefore, Imam, at that 11th hour, he said, Allah, Allah, bisalati, fa innahu imadu dinikum. Before Imam left this world, these are the last words Imam was saying. Allah, Allah, oh my lovers and followers, salah, because salah is the pillar of your religion. Therefore, Rasulullah said, imadu din, in qubila, Salat is the pillar of our deen. If Salat is accepted, all other deeds and actions will be accepted. But if your Salah is rejected, all other deeds, say Hajj, say Zakat, say charity, they will not be accepted and they will be interrogated one after the other. The same thing you come to Aba Abdullah al-Husayn, salawatullahi wa salamahu alayhi. When we recite the majlis and the musibah of Ali ibn al-Akbar, the moment we start discussing about the adhan of Ali ibn al-Akbar, how many of us burst in tears? We all cry. But the meaning of that adhan is telling us how important Salat was in the eye of Aba Abdullah al-Husayn. Therefore, on that 10th day of Muharram, Abu Thumamah al-Sa'idi, he came towards Aba Abdullah and he said, Ya Aba Abdullah, the enemies are making headways, but I don't want to die until and unless I perform my zuhur. Aba Abdullah called out, Umar, let us perform our salah. Later on, they responded. Beginning, they did not respond that you can perform your salah. But Aba Abdullah made dua for Abu Thumamah al-Sa'idi. Ja'alaka Allahu min al-musallin al-dhakirin. Oh, Abu Thumamah, the fact that you are conscious of your salah at this particular stage of our preparation to go and defend Islam, may Allah list your name among those who establish salah and remember Allah. Salah. Therefore, our beloved Imam, Aba Abdullah al-Husayn, when he was in that field of Karbala, we all know Bibi Zainab. When Aba Abdullah looked at Zainab, he requested one thing from Zainab. La tansini fi salati al-layl. Zainab, do not forget me in your night salah. In that difficult situation, Ahlul Bayt alayhim salatu wassalam never forgot their salah. What of I and you are free? Therefore, our beloved Imam, the Sif Imam, it's just introduction. Imam Jafar al-Sadiq, salawatullahi wa salamuhu alayhi. He said, لا ينال شفاعتنا من استخف بالصلاة. Imam Jafar said, Wallahi, he will not attain our shafa on the day of Qiyamah who undermines salah. Yani, if you are a Shia of Imam Jafar Sadiq alayhi salam, and you undermine your salah and you do not perform your salah, Imam Jafar said, you will not meet our shafa on the day of Qiyamah. So that tells us how serious the question of salah is in the eye of Allah and in the eyes of the prophets of Allah and in the teachings of Ahl Bayt al-Asma wa al-Tahara. Now let's come to the second step. Do we need salat or not? Because some of us, when we pray, it's like we are doing favor to Allah. Do we need salah or we don't need salah? You know, in psychology, they have a theory. They said, fa'iliyatul hadaf, masubatun bi-insijam dhat al-insan al-hadif. They said the effectiveness of every aim and objective in life. Yani, for an aim or objective to materialize positively, it has to conform with the passion of the holder of that aim. What does it mean? You want to become a medical doctor. But if your passion and your emotions are not in love of being a medical doctor, you may not be successful. If you call your son, I want you to become a Maulana, and he does not have the passion to become a Maulana, and you force him to become, he will not be a successful Maulana. So they said, for an aim and objective to be effective, it has to conform with one's passion. It has to respond to your natural need. It has to respond to your natural desire. Now we all know as to why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created it. I mentioned that. Allah created us to worship. That's how Allah mentioned in Quran, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. Question. Does this ibadah respond to our natural need or not? It's a question. Because Allah said, I created so that you perform salah, you establish it. I created so that you observe fasting. I created you so that you go for Hajj. Does it respond to my emotional need? Does it respond to my psychological need? Does it respond to my mental need or not? If we realize that it does not respond to our need naturally, then it means we are just doing wazifat responsibility. And if it is wazifa responsibility, it means it loses its essence completely. But now, if we find out that salat responds to our natural need and our emotions and desires and our instinct, then we don't need someone to remind us of salat. We have to do it by ourselves. As Imam Amir al-Mumin mentioned, I do not worship him because I want to go to Jannah. And I do not worship him because I'm scared of fire, but I worship him because he deserved to be worshipped. Because Mawla realized that salah responds to our natural need. It conforms to our natural desire. It conforms to the need of our emotions. Now I tell you, we need salah because of the following factors. And these are natural needs. I mentioned some of them in my previous speech on the day I spoke about dua. The first one, you need salah because you need sukoon in your heart. If you want sukoon and inner peace, you will not get it anywhere except through ibadah. Therefore, Allah mentioned in Quran, "Inna al-insana khulika halu'a." Man is created with fear. All of us sitting here, there is no one who does not have fear. You know what is that fear? You're scared whether you lose your job. You're scared whether this business that is going well, the tenders are coming right, will it stop or not? There is no one who does not have fear. Quran mentioned, "Inna al-insana khulika halu'a." You're scared whether this year you'll even be able to break even or not. Everybody has that fear. And the only way to overcome that fear is through ibadah. Why through ibadah? Because ibadah is getting in contact and connection with the source of mercy. When I make salah and I make ibadah, I'm getting connected with the source of mercy. Therefore, Allah mentioned in Quran, "Ala bi dhikrillah tatma'innu al-qulub." It is only through the remembrance of Allah that you find peace in your heart. So number one, we need ibadah, we need salah, we need fasting for inner peace. Because inner peace, you cannot buy it with money. You can only gain it through your ibadah and the worship of Allah. Number two, we need ibadah. Why do we need ibadah? It's because you need to express yourself with Allah. As they mentioned, if you want Allah to talk to you, you recite Quran. But if you want to talk to Allah, you perform salah. Establishing salah is communicating to Allah. You are telling Allah, you are expressing yourself with Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Number three, we need salah and ibadah because we need to charge our inner machine. You're inside that inner machine. You need to charge it. And how does salah help us to charge our inner machine? You know, life of this world is just mata'ib. It's all tiredness and pain. Today you are okay, the next day another problem happens, challenge. Today you have a headache and the headache is cured, another day another headache is coming somewhere. You are busy with this problem, you are done with it. By the time you realize another, that's the nature. Rich people are crying, poor people are crying, ulama are crying, the ma'mumin are crying, musallin are crying, thieves are crying, government is crying. Is there anyone who does not cry in this world? When somebody tells you I'm a happy 100%, it's just understatement. Everybody has got this. Somebody will tell me and my boss, Allahu Akbar. Somebody said mosque is this. Somebody said madrasa is this. Everybody has his own unique problem. And I can tell you, you cannot find solution to this problem until you establish your salat and ibadah. Why? Because Allah mentioned in Quran, wasta'inu bis-sabri was-salah. In all these difficulties of life, you need one power. That is the power of sabr. And Allah said, if you seek assistance from Allah to get sabr, seek it through salah. Wasta'inu bis-sabri was-salah. Because you know, many people, when they have problems and stress, you know what we do? We take a nap, isn't it? Because you take a nap for 2 hours, you say, no, I need power nap. You know, people, they like that terminology. Once you get a power nap or powerful nap, I don't know how they say it. Now, alhamdulillah, you'll be charged. Allah comes in Surah Al-Muzammil and said, even the sleep in the nap will not solve your problem. What will solve your problem? Allah said, "Inna sanulki alayka kawlan thaqila. Inna nashi'at al-layli hiya ashaddu wata'an wa aqwa maqila." Allah said, yes, you may sleep. And you may think it will solve the problem. But that sleeping will solve it temporarily. What will solve your problem? I say, inna nasha'at al-layl. Waking up at night to stand to worship Allah, it will give life to your souls. That's the power of salah. You need salah to get to that level. When Rasulullah said, as-salatu mi'rajul mu'min. Salah makes mu'min to ascend to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And one riwayah said, salat qurbanu kull taqi. Salat is the sacrifice of every believer. Yani, when you perform salah, you have sacrificed your soul to be taken to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So therefore, salah, brothers and sisters, is a very powerful mechanism to help us going about our lives in this world. Now, the next point is, what is the standard salat in the eye of Allah? The salat that is capable of taking you high to Allah. Here, scholars came forward and divided ibadah into two. They said, every worship that you observe, you can look at it from two dimensions. And I want you to pay attention here. we are discussing Salah, so we limit it to Salah. The first aspect of that worship, they call it Ibadah Mulki. And the other dimension, they call it Ibadah Malakuti or Gaibi. What is the first one? It is an Ibadah by show of strength. I start with fasting. We all fasting. This abstinence from food and water is just show of strength. Everybody can do. Christians can do it. Hindus can do it. Sikhs can do it. Is that the philosophy of fasting? No. Salat. When I stand, I make qiyam, ruku, sujood. Is that what Allah wants? No. Everybody can do that exercise. This exercise is not a big deal. You go to Hajj Safa and Marwa, you see a very honorable person, minister, is running Safa and Marwa, going and come. Is that what Allah wants? No. That's what they call Ibadah Mulki. It's Ibadah by show of strength. What does Allah want behind all this exercise? They call it Ibadah Malakuti. Now let's come to Salah. What is that divine dimension of Salat? That is what Allah explained in Quran. Inna Salata tanha anil fakhsha'i wal munkar. Salat is to change your attitude. Salat is to change your behavior. Salat is to change your thinking. Salat is to change your approach. So therefore, this exercise, ruku, sujood, is prerequisite to take you to the objective of salah. That is to change your akhlaq and to make you insan and better person in the eye of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But how many of us are able to achieve that? Has salah changed your attitude? Or workshop change your attitude? Is your salat capable of changing your attitude? 10 years you've been performing? 20 years? 15 years? 100 years? Has it changed your attitude? Has salat changed your akhlaq? Has salat changed your behavior? Because that is the philosophy of salah. Even Ramadan, we fasting now. It is to change our behavior. It is to change our akhlaq. It is to make us better people. It is to make us better human beings. And Allah made it very clear. Inna salata tan'a anil fakhsha'i wal munkar. When your salah is standard salah and accepted by Allah, you are far away from any sin. Why? Because when sin starts to come towards you, your salat will block that sin from coming. Now, if our salat up until now has not stopped that from gossiping, from backbiting, from deceiving, from cheating, it means our salat has remained only with the salat of showing exercise. We need to move from there. Now our salat has to go to Salatul Malakuti, the divine salah. Fasubhanalladhi biyadihi malakuti kulli shay. We need to move now. Everybody has to move, young and old, father and mother, brother and sister, daughter and son. We need now to move. We don't want our salah to be only salah that will remain this exercise, ruku, sujood, ruku, sujood, subhanallah wala. No, I want my salah to manifest in my life. Therefore, scholars mention, when we talk of a definition of ibadah, ibadah means nothing but to transfer the humility you obtain during salah into your life. You know, when you are performing salah, you become humble. Allahu Akbar. You see, you are humble. You don't want even someone to push you. You don't want something to temper with your salah. They said that humbleness and humility, which you find when you are performing salah, has to be transferred outside in your life. Once it is transferred outside, then that salat is regarded as accepted salah. Now my time is short. What do you do to make your salat accepted salah? To make it salat malakuti? There is one thing you need, but that one thing comes with a lot of package. Khushu'. You need khushu'. humility and humbleness during Salat time. And this khushu has different requirements and levels. I will mention a few of them for brothers and sisters to start learning them and start implementing it in their lives. This khushu, when you have it, you will enjoy the taste of salah. Salat has a different taste, brothers and sisters. I don't know how much taste we have gained from our salah. And if you want to understand the taste of salah, look at your salah and salat of Rasulullah and Ahlul Bayt. Rasulullah said, جُعِلَتُ قُرَّةَ عَيْنُ اللِّي فِي الصَّلَاةِ. Allah placed the comfort of my eye in salah. And he said, Allah instilled the love of my salat in the heart, like the way instilled the love of food in the heart of the hungry, and the love of water in the heart of the thirsty. Then Rasulullah said, the hungry, when he eats, he gets satisfied. And thirsty, when he drinks, it quenches thirst. But I do not get satisfied of salah. It's not enough. Rasulullah said, it's not enough. Therefore, when you look at the salat of Rasulullah, Rasulullah prepared in advance before salah. Therefore, he would look at Bilal al-Khabashi and said to Bilal, an hour, 30 minutes before salah, arihna biha ya Bilal. Oh, Bilal, provide us peace of mind by making azan. Do you get peace of mind when you perform salah? Or it is a heavy block here, you want to get rid of it. You want to throw it. Rasulullah will tell Bilal, arihna biha ya Bilal. Oh Bilal, give us rahat through salah. And you know salat, Rasulullah explained, when you go to perform your salah, it's like a lika ul mashuk. You are going to meet your beloved. And when you have to go and meet your beloved, you have to prepare, isn't it? And you get tired when you are with your beloved. You miss your wife, you miss your son. When you go and meet him, do you just get in a hurry, you want to go? So salat is salatul khushu'. But now let's list some of these maratib of khushu', some of these prerequisites of khushu', what you need to do for you to get that humility and khushu' in your salah. The first one is hudurul qalb, the presence of the heart. You know, if you perform salah and your heart is not there, you don't enjoy salah. And most of us, when we perform, the heart is not there. The presence of the heart means you must give all concentration in that salah. Or else you will not enjoy that salah. Therefore, you find Imam Zain al-Abidin, whenever he was going to perform salah, he will start shivering and the complex of his face will start changing. And they would ask Imam Zain al-Abidin, what is happening? Then he would ask them, do you know in front of who I'm going to stand? You need the presence of the heart. And you know how do you gain presence of the heart? You wait for salah. You don't allow salah to wait for you. Because if you don't wait for salah, especially you are at work, you need to prepare maybe 10 minutes, 15 minutes before salah. Psychologically, you make dua, wudu, and that dua will prepare you to enter into salah. But if you don't do that, and you wait, some they wait until azan gone finish, until ikama gone finish, then they will rush. You know, the moment you get there, what will be stuck in your mind is the last transaction or conversation you had with someone. Now you are performing salah, and that is going back and forth in your mind. Therefore, Amir al-Mu'mineen saw someone performing salah, and the person was playing with his beard. You know, some people, when they perform salah, he scratch this side, he do like this, he do like this, some they do like this, alhamdulillah. You know what Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen said? Imam looked at him, after salah, he called him, nicely. He said, you know, we have two types of thieves. We have a material thief and you have spiritual thief. Said material thief is the one who steals
people's belonging. Imam said that's not a big deal. Spiritual thief is the one who steals the taste of the soul. He said the way you perform your salah, you have stolen the taste of your soul completely. Therefore, in one riwayah, he said, لَوْ خَشَعَتِ الْقُلُوبِ لَخَشَعَتِ الْجَوَارِحِ. If there is a fear of Allah in the heart, then that fear of Allah will go into the body. So number one, you need the presence of the heart. And the presence of the heart, you get it when you wait for salah. You don't allow salah to wait for you. Number two, you have to respect the salah. If you do not respect the salah, then your salah will have no positive impact in your life. You need to respect your salah. Where you pray, you have to respect it. The chastity of the place, the cleanliness of the place, the purity of the place, you have to be particular about it. And lastly, as they taught us through the teachings of Ahlul Bayt, whenever you go for ruku in your salah, they said your ruku should be that you are ready to sacrifice yourself for Allah. In what sense? Yani, you want to give life to Allah, your soul to Allah. How? They said it's like when somebody said he want to behead you, and you put your head like this. This is how you go into ruku. They said when you go to ruku, it means I've given all my entire life to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they said when you do qunut, you raise up your hand as if something is falling for you to catch up from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So therefore, in conclusion, brothers and sisters, our salat is very, very important. Let's take our salat very, very seriously. It will help us in our life of this world, and it will help us in our life of the day of Qiyamah. We ask Allah to help us, inshallah. وَصَلِّ اللَّهُمَّ عَلَى مُحَمَّدٍ وَآلِهِ الطَّاهِرِينَ